Yo, what it does, this the big boss, Ricky Ross. You under the dig? And it's pretty much like the making. I was putting together in my yay on the cocaine capital. It's a reality for everybody that's from Miami. That's too big. The biggest shit is.
10
Police have grounded the rest of the world. Made that world famous.
Booby Boys. To protect Kenneth's Booby Williams flourishing drug business that stretched from Miami through Georgia, Carolinas, and into Virginia, even as far as Detroit.
This is a throwback to the 80s when we had the cocaine cowboys. But this is brand new for us in the 90s now that we haven't experienced this in the last few years.
Are you in the John Joes? What are they like?
We're best. We have dismantled the largest violent drug group in Overtown and Liberty City, along with a second major competitor.
Like you said, they traced the drugs back to you.
Police say their weapon of choice was the AK-47 assault rifle.
In Miami, with Scarface, that was dope.
Boogie Bird is an entrepreneur. On the street, however you want to put it. You know what I'm saying?
Bert was real cool. He was kind of flashy. Everything he had to be a conversion.
Prosecutors dubbed Falcone and Magluta cocaine kingpins who, over a 13-year period, smuggled 75 tons of Colombian cocaine into the United States. They were accused of trafficking more than $2 billion of the white stuff.
Bunky was like the man. Bunky, if there was any problem, you holler at Bunky.
He's going to take over the business now that you're handcuffed.
Yeah, what it does, this the big boss, Ricky Ross, and my yayo, the cocaine capital.
Turf warfare. It was all about drugs, and it was all about, selling drugs, making money. It was all greed, but very violent groups. We had to deal with the Booby Boys, we had Banda's gang, had the John Does. They were all fighting for turf.
But what happened is these guys kind of organized and everybody, end up getting territories. And when they end up getting territories and getting control of certain areas, what end up happening is, then they created the gangs.
Hand grenades, just some of the things cops get in a huge bust today. That story coming up on News 4 at 6.
War is raging on the streets of Miami. A war that's leaving a trail of death.
This gun was not acquired and purchased by this group to go out deer hunting.
See the ricochet of the bullet up here?
And the victim was hit multiple times, including a number of rounds fired at close range after he'd fallen down.
You are looking at what these gangs are fighting over. Turf.
This side our name, probably got rich people on that side. You got the immigrants and the poor people.
When you live in these kinds of conditions, no electricity, no running water, as you can see, 90% of the buildings are boarded up.
At what point do you get tired of eating spam? You don't want to stay. I got with my homie Chris Lawson. That's who directed the video. First, I'm pretty sure he was skeptical when I told him I wanted to do a countdown of the 10 realest niggas that, grace the streets of the MIAO. Top 10 dudes in MIAO. All real G's, man. All real niggas, man. We gonna set number 10 off with John Doe, Liberty City. Corey Bubba Smith, Trav, Anthony Phil. This story that captivated the streets of Miami. You know what I'm saying? These dudes most definitely were highly recognized when it came to street politics. Finna go into the lives of the notorious John Doe gang. Believe that right here in my ear. It's number 10. Boss.
The important thing to these people is territory. That's the valuable commodity. A human life is not. In fact, a dead person is more valuable to them than a live person because it's like a trophy.
Anthony Fail grew up in this area over here. He grew up in the Scott Projects also, which is off of Northwest 22nd Avenue.
Around Christmas time, 96. I ran into him at a little show going up there at Miami Nights, Studio 183. And he came through there with the little John Doe set, you know what I'm saying? But,
well, they said, I don't know. It's the head of the John Doe boys.
Yeah, it was a beautiful holiday weekend, Christmas, and we had four execution-style gangland murders in a row within a two-day period.
Really, the blood got bad, really, really about, you know, it was some beef, really. I hate to say it, but it really was about, you know, on some hoe shit, you know what I'm saying? Bo had a little hoe. He was vibing at the time. And one of them niggas from that set, you know, tried the little hoe, slapped the little hoe or something. Bo took that person like, you know, nigga know that's my hoe. Gonna slap the hoe and know that's my hoe. So, you know, he went off or whatever and ran down on the nigga with his little homie, young nigga named Ken Wong. And, you know, Bo slapped him or whatever with the pistol and Ken Wong just went head on and, you know, gave him the business.
According to police, Robinson was killed in retaliation to a rival gang murder that took place less than 12 hours earlier, also in Liberty City. 20-year-old Billy D. Walker was shot and killed while sitting in his car. Walker was killed in retaliation for the Christmas night murder of 30-year-old rival gang member Mark Couch. This graphic surveillance video shows the brutal and deliberate shooting, but Couch's murder was merely retaliation for yet another murder. 15-year-old Jarvis Hilbert shot down earlier on Christmas Day. Hilbert's life taken because of this horrific murder on August 30th. 26-year-old Angel Bennett Wilson. Police say Wilson was the girlfriend of this man, Anthony DeJuan Fail, who was a big shot with the John Doe gang, but left to start a gang of his own. Cops want him because they say his actions started the bloodshed.
John Doe felt like dude was in their circle. So regardless of who you is, you know, you done tried our set. You know what I'm saying? So that's the beef went to going tiff and tat at that point. You know, the little beef popped off. Bo went to, you know, pressing them niggas or whatever, trying to get the niggas who was supposed to be the shooters on Ken Wong. And in the process, you know, Angel got killed. You know what I'm saying? They had him pinned down somewhere over this nigga house. Angel came through scooping, shook the niggas, let Bo out, and fired off. And when they ran back down on the car, Bo had done got out. So, you know, they in their feelings because he done got away and they had him. So they weren't going to let that bitch escape route no more. So they went ahead on and did it to Angel. You know, that's why I got this tattoo of the Angel. It ain't that good. It's a prison tat. You know, I just got out the front.
Try not to panic so much by every 5 seconds saying shots are fired, shots are fired. It's going to go on. We know it's going to happen. People are going to be celebrating in a way that they hope they don't celebrate. They're going to get shooting. And you know it's going to happen a lot. So don't get into the habit every 10 seconds. Shots are fired. It's coming from the area. 10 blocks that way, 10 blocks that way. If you do that, it's going to tap the air all night long.
But this New Year's Eve could be even more dangerous because of Anthony Fail and all the gang violence directed tonight at the police.
They are going to set up lots of rooftop snipers against the police. We got another call stating that they were going to use grenades against the police.
11:30, get your officers in. My philosophy has been when I was a sergeant, I get all my guys in. We meet somewhere, we're inside. We're not out there 11:30 to 12. We're not. I don't care what's going on.
It was a scary time. Not only for the community, but for the police department as well. In fact, there were multiple death threats on police officers' lives, particularly during like holidays, New Year's Eve, when you have shooting anyway. Instead of firecrackers, people will sometimes use guns. And we had intelligence on New Year's Eve, as 98 turned to 99, that people were gonna be up on rooftops with sniper rifles, shooting cops as they drove through, and throwing grenades. Fortunately, that didn't happen, but that was one of the things we were concerned about. This particular death threat during the John Doe days really shook the police department. They took it very, very seriously, and they wanted to put a bodyguard on me around the clock and my home. I asked them not to. I said, I just want to go on and live my life. This just shows I'm doing my job well. And I think that even though these guys may be cold-blooded killers, they're not crazy to try to kill a cop.
Meanwhile, up to 35 officers carrying their own high-powered weapons continue to scrutinize the northwest part of Miami, pursuing every lead about every major drug dealer that comes in. And they have been warned that a mystery caller has threatened that the John Doe drug gang will retaliate against them with sniper fire from rooftops.
Fire Stoppers, can I help you? He's there now.
There's a Chevy green backed up in the yard. It's running.
Beige and brown house.
He's wearing all black.
What color is this car?
It's souped up.
More than 400 calls to Crime Stoppers about Anthony Fail and his former gang, the John Doe Boys. A police task force following every viable tip.
He's everywhere.
They're leading off the street. And however we have to do that, if the public turns him in, that's fine. If he turns himself in.
Something Miami's most wanted is not likely to do.
Man, it got so crazy in the city where it was that them crackers started not to put poles down where you couldn't even come on 61. You can't even come off 62nd and go on 61. All that shit was blocked out in the daytime. Alex Pinellas was in office. His ass was out there with a bulletproof vest on. You know what I'm saying? Lil Bo, he can't give a fuck. Basically, he like, you know what I'm saying? He like, man, these crackers gonna see, they gotta take me dead alive, you know what I'm saying? You know, he wasn't with the crazy, you know what I'm saying? He wasn't with that whole giving up easy nigga. Are you coming to get me? Come on. Every day, nigga, it'd be 2 o'clock in the afternoon and you'll be on the one. You'll be at the store, nigga, shootouts. Straight up, choppers, SK, niggas whacking at each other.
Hey, it's hot up in there, man. Hey, tell them they shoot across the street too, man.
Finally, the cops decide it's just too crazy out there.
Hey, let's get in our cars and get the hell out of here.
They take the advice they got at roll call and come in for cover just before midnight.
The state attorney's office was involved in the drug fight with us. That's some drug fighting going on.
We saw young people, juveniles, get into violence in a degree that we had never witnessed before.
What we did is there was a task force that was put together to address this issue because these weren't users. These were just very violent criminals.
We have a special team of dedicated agents with a supervisor that will come into that town at the request of the sheriff or the chief with direction from the sheriff and the chief and work that particular area, working violent crime, standards of living issues in a community and look to eradicate problems for the chief. Usually they'll last 3 or 4 months. We go in, we do the job for the chief, and then we come out.
Eventually that's how everything got knocked down. Everything got closed up by the feds. You know, really the local police. The feds came in and put everybody in jail.
Cops cracking down in Liberty City after they link more than 20 murders there to drug gang warfare. This indictment connects the John Does to 6 murders, mostly rival gang members, or John Does who left the gang. But one murder centers around this man, the alleged leader of the John Does, Corey Smith. Agents say Smith's gang killed a woman to protect him. The woman was set to testify against Smith in a murder trial. 2 days before that could happen, she turned up dead.
These are some of the profile sheets that we've put together on some of the members.
While Fail was behind bars, a gang called the John Does took over the streets of Liberty City. The members, especially leader Corey Smith, were Fail's childhood friends. Miami detective Frank Alfonso says the John Does are one of the best opportunities going around here, despite the job hazards.
I will point out to murders in the area that happen within the immediate area that they control. The career that these drug dealers choose usually always leads to two things in their lives. And one is death, and the other is jail. And they're aware of that. They're very, very aware of that level and, you know, what their expectations are. But they choose to live that great life, as they call it.
Miami police spokesman Lieutenant Bill Schwartz says his department hasn't seen a criminal as ruthless as Anthony Fail in a long time.
Well, as you can see, this is the rap sheet of Anthony Fail. It goes all the way to the ground here, all the way to the floor. A murder in the first degree, firearm possession, armed robbery, homicide, willful intent to kill. I guess the last line here is the one that we have to be most concerned with as cops, and that is caution. Armed and extremely dangerous. Mr. Fail is, I would say, Miami's public enemy number one.
We understand he might be wearing some disguises, but we'll get him.
And you have to appreciate he's not just hiding from us, he's hiding from people that would look to shoot him.
You know, but by Bo being wanted, where, you know, he had the little shit where he, you know, had it all on film, ran into the little A-Rab, hit the little girl in the shoulder with the little fire, run chasing some nigga. And he really wanted for that, so I grabbed him, you know, and took him with me up the road we had out or whatever.
Tracking Anthony Fail has been frustrating. At one point, this officer thought he spotted Fail in a car and gave chase.
Well, in this case, the officer did the best he could, but his tire went flat.
Oh, man, it was chaos. So many people, cars was getting stopped. Like, there he is, so many people fit the description. They stop him, he'll stop everybody there, but he wasn't even here. A lot of the things they was blaming him for, he wasn't even here. So the media put you in places and you in another place, so me, I don't get caught up with the black folks' hair.
Homicide, something never. He had somebody over his house. The guy had a drug overdose and died.
Soon the reward's up to $10,000, and hundreds of people are still calling the police.
Who's that? Billy Walker's car?
Some to cash in, some legitimately to help, with all kinds of information.
It's going to be a 1982 or 84 gray Chevy Caprice.
Rental cars Anthony Fail may be driving, hotels where he may be staying, safe houses provided by his network of friends.
One of my first involvements was the incident at the store where Anthony Fail is seen clearly on camera chasing a guy into a store, shooting at him, and hitting a 9-year-old behind the corner. And the irony of that is that same 9-year-old, the father of the owner of that store, was killed in that store several years before in a shooting. And I was a homicide investigator during that time. But he was shot in the head, not related to this, but also because of drug enterprise. Anthony Fail decided that after Corey was down, after Corey was out, Anthony decided, you know what, the enterprise can't stay the way it is. I need to take leadership. Sort of like the story of the old Russian czars when they would actually fight for power. Lil Bo decided that it was time for Lil Bo to step up. And when he decided to step into that slot, there were those that opposed him. There were those that said, you know what, we like the enterprise the way it's going. We're the lieutenants in this. We're the bosses in this. And this is going to be our faction. So, but, you know, this is going to be our faction. We're going to run this enterprise. Well, Lil Bo decided, no, that's not the way things are going to happen. So I've got to eliminate those that get in my way. And that's what he started to do systematically. He started to go out and eliminate those that would oppose him. We had a couple of shootings that were caught, I think, on tape. Mark Couch was shot, and we had the situation with the little girl. And, you know, these things were actually caught on tape. He was brazen, bold, broad daylight shootings in the streets of Miami.
He wasn't about killing nobody. But if you're going to kill me and I see you, don't you think it's common sense to get you before you get me?
He into the gunplay. That's what he do, you know what I'm saying? If a nigga ain't, if it is on site with him, you know what I'm saying, he ain't going to lay on you. If he catch you and you know, if you supposed to get it, you gonna get it where he catch you at.
Anthony Fail, I know him as Bo. I mean, that's family. I mean, you know, we cool, you know what I'm saying? I've been knowing Bo since I was a jit.
By 16, Fail was already serving a 7-year sentence in state prison for a pair of back-to-back violent crimes. In one case, he pulled someone out of a car at gunpoint and ripped off their money and jewelry. He was charged with 2 counts of armed robbery and 2 counts of attempted murder.
Anthony Fair, you know what I'm saying? The notorious little Bo, you know what I'm saying? That's my dog. You know, we linked up in the joint, the state joint. You know, I was in on a little armed robbery beef. Bo had done what a nigga in the dice game because he been squeezing. He was about 15. You know, he rolled out, did about 7 back then.
Tipped that Anthony Fail was up in Palm Beach County. and we had about 15 or 20 Miami detectives, a few Metro Dade detectives, and then a number of FBI agents up there looking for him. And we found a car he was using at a hotel.
With the help of the motel's night manager, 30 to 40 police officers evacuate every room at the Days Inn, except for one, Anthony Fales. They have to move fast. By now, the local TV stations have heard everything over the police scanner and threaten to blow the setup.
One of the stations went live from the scene and showed Anthony Fales' photo and said that we're at a hotel in Palm Beach County. They're getting ready to go in and arrest him with the SWAT team.
Given the media presence and Fales' status as armed and dangerous, police decide to enter the room using flash grenades.
A distraction device that initially has a bright flash of light and then a high level of noise.
As it turns out, police got lucky.
The bad guy had pizza delivered, and they waited a sufficient time to ensure that he was in the middle of his pizza, distracted in that manner when they made entry, and it worked very successfully.
The TV was on, and he was arrested. Luckily for us, he just didn't have the right station on.
After 8 days and thousands of man hours, and despite the media's recklessness, Anthony Fales is finally in police custody. He is not charged with any of the gangland murders, but he is charged with the case he skipped bail on, plus the videotaped convenience store shooting. The police have a lot of questions for Anthony Fales about his activities and those of his former gang, the John Does. For reasons the police won't divulge, Anthony Fales waives his right to an attorney and talks to them for 12 hours.
And when I get to the little federal building Bub, you know, in a little holding cell, so when I first come in and I see Bub, I'm like, damn, you know what I'm saying? I know him a Bo Beef, you know, that's my dog. Yeah, you know, he know that's my dog, that's what it is. So when I come through, Bub tell the niggas, you know, tell the CO, yeah, put him in here, you know what I'm saying? So I'm like, okay, I ain't tripping, yeah, go and put me in there. So when I walk in there, you know, Bub was like, what's up, man? You know, I ain't beefing or whatever, you know what I'm saying? I just wanted to holler at you, my nigga, because I want you to ask your homeboy why he gave them crackers a 12-hour confession on me, right? So I'm like, what? You know, you... So immediately, you know, I'm like, you know, I'm rejecting that deposit off rip. I'm like, what? You got my dog fucked up. He's like, yeah, man, he gave the crackers a little 12-hour confession on me. And, you know, I don't mind him fighting for his life, because that was he supposed to do all the work or whatever, but he ain't had to tell them crackers all that kind of shit on me. That ain't, you know, that ain't the code, right?
He was able to discuss with us a lot of what we saw happening in the previous, say, 60 days in the Model Cities area that helped us get some insight into all the different groups and the pressures and the pushing and pulling on the retail drug sales and who was mad at who and who was shooting them.
Afterwards, the media feeding frenzy continues when detectives present Fales for a photo op conveniently in time for the evening news. This customary display is known as the perp walk. Fales uses the moment to deny the charges. The police won't give specifics of what Fales talked to them about, but the next day, 25 of his former John Doe associates are arrested by the U.S. Attorney's Office.
He had dismantled the largest violent drug group in Overtown and Liberty City, along with a second major competitive group in one swoop. They were competing, they had this different drug holes, different organizations, and fighting for the same customers.
The question is, was Anthony Fales ever the real object of Operation Draw the Line? Or did the police just use him as leverage to get to the John Does?
Are you in the John Does? What are they like?
Who is that?
What
that
John Doe gang, you know what it is.
Know what that is.
Are you a gang member, sir?
No.
26 indicted today. Federal agents say 16 are connected to the John Does, formerly called the Lynch Mob. 10 are allegedly connected to a splinter group called the Cloud Nine Organization. Members of both gangs face federal charges of dealing crack cocaine, money laundering, and illegal firearm possession. All no bond offenses with the possibility of life in prison.
We started the countdown off with John Doe at number 10. Now we're coming in at number 9, Vonda Jackson. I never got the opportunity to meet Vonda. Heard a lot of things. a lot of trill stories. You know what I mean? So she coming in right here, number 9. Talents for life, I see y'all. Yeah.
Fonda was the only female in the crew that Blackman thought they were going to walk over Fonda because she was a female, which didn't happen. Fonda went to war just as well as them dudes that went, you know what I mean? Fonda was a true gangster, you know, don't let the fact that she was a female fool you, bro.
I knew Fonda from Overtown, and to me, Fonda found her a space that she could do her thing. She had her little girls. Fonda to me was just like a person, found them a spot that they can exist in and do their thing. You know, how big she got or what she became, I really didn't know because I ended up in the federal prison system. So, hey, it is what it is. Yeah.
I remember Fonda when she was a little girl. In fact, she grew up in the neighborhood that I grew up in. I remember she was running around with two of my daughters. I had two daughters about the same age that she was. And I used to watch them play in the yard, and she was always someone of a little leader.
Outgoing, you know what I'm saying, fun-loving, easy to get along with. She get along with anybody. And just as easy as she is to get along with, she'll set you straight in a minute.
I don't know if you saw this movie, New Jack City, and they had the chick with the gun that was rockabobby, and them bunnies had chicks like that, just like that. But, you know, in the movie, I mean, it was just make believe in the movie, but she had hooked it down gangster women with her that would do that.
The cheerleaders need a uniform, they could go to Fonda. Fonda would give them a couple of $100. Buy the cheerleaders uniforms when they ain't had. The kids needed shoes to go to school. You could go to Fonda and get that from them. Fonda was a real good woman.
She'd rent a van and take the kids to Disney World or the pizza. She'd have a DJ, especially if they had something like a graduation.
Wow, what she used to do like on an Easter. She used to get a lot of the girls to dress up like bunnies, and she dressed up like an Easter bunny too, and they had the eggs and the costumes, yeah, for the kids. They even had things for the grown-ups too. It just, everybody just participated in it. But she was the one did all the, you know, the buying and the giving. You know, the kids were, oh man, they couldn't wait for Easter to come or either Christmas to come, because they know Fonda was going to do something.
Fonda just was put in a bad situation. She's a real good friend of mine. You know what I'm saying? She always throw good parties, never was a troublemaker. They just put her name in a lot of circumstances.
From what I hear, it was rah-rah that kind of got Fonda screwed up, because he lied saying that she paid him to go kill this girl. He killed some girl. He killed that girl because the girl took some stuff out of his car, stole some stuff out of his car. And then when he found out Fonda and the girl had some kind of beef or something, then he went down there. But I think he deserved everything he got.
McBride was, to me, now he was a good dude. You know. They killed him over there. This dude named Rara. They said Rara killed him at the behest of somebody else.
That ain't the first time. I remember that time he was laying on the roof. He's supposed to shot McBride or somebody in that hole. He was up there. I remember he was up there. And then the dude, Papa Star, he killed Papa Star. Papa Star stayed in the building behind that. He was on the roof that time when he shot that boy, Papa Star.
We said, oh God, they don't got Fonda. And the way they portrayed her in the newspaper, it was like they were talking about another person. You know, I'm thinking of Fonda and what she was doing for the community and the kids, not all that, like, killing and the guns and all that and contracts. Nah, that wasn't Fonda. No, that had to be another Fonda. That wasn't a Fonda Jackson. No.
She got 20 years, but she got 20 years for 2 grams of cocaine. They convicted her for 2 grams of cocaine. They didn't convict her for none of the murders. They didn't convict her for none of the gang-related stuff. They convicted her for 2 grams of cocaine.
And they lied on that show. That girl ain't with no killer. They ain't never killed nobody. Shit. These men, none of them, they ain't doing nothing. Nothing doing nothing. At least she was doing something for the black community. They ain't never built no house or nothing. They might not be able to build none for these, because these Cubans ain't taking the money doing what they supposed to do with it. These old males, they ain't nothing. They ain't about doo-doo.
I don't think Vonda got a good trial, because she did too much in her young years for them to give her that much time. It ought to be down further than that or out, because she tried her best. I didn't see her do nothing. It might happen, but I didn't see it.
Number 10 was John Doe. Number 9 was Vonda Jackson. You clearly see where we're going.